Hey, welcome back. So today we're going to be talking about part two for a complex circuit problem, how to use Kirchhoff's rules, the loop rule and the junction rule. And I am updating this to demonstrate how to solve this problem in two completely different ways using both of Kirchhoff's rules. So let's go ahead and get to it. So the first thing I want you to do is imagine that there's a pipe with a pump attached to it, and the height of the water is going to be pumped up to 12 meters. What is the height drop for the unknown waterfall with rapids area designated by the question mark? So take a look at this and think for a moment and anticipate what you think the answer is going to be here. All right, for the unknown height drop with this waterfall right here, you're going to have a -3 meters drop, you could say. And it's a good visual representation of the idea that the sum of these numbers should be equal to zero. And that is Kirchhoff's loop rule in an analogous sense. So I'm going to show you how to use that in a circuit problem later on as well. So if we were to summarize Kirchhoff's loop rule, we could say the sum of all the potential difference around a loop is zero. This is an important rule that you're going to need to know. And here's some math that kind of backs up what we were just talking about. And it turns out that that drop, of course, is going to be -3 meters. Okay, so let's go back to the problem that we had started last time. With that last screencast, I had worked out how to do equivalent resistances for a complex circuit. And if we start thinking about the current that's going to flow through these different resistors, A, B, C, D, and E, it turns out that the current must be the same through A, D, and E, because that's the only pathway that the current can flow through. And so if we say the current for A is equal to D is equal to E, that's true. But the point that I want to get to that's a little more subtle is that sum of that current is going to be distributed through pathways B and C. So this current total, say through D, should equal the sum of B and C. And that's Kirchhoff's junction rule. So the sum of the currents flowing into a junction is equal to the sum of the currents flowing out of that junction. That also makes sense, right? So pretty straightforward, and I'm going to show you how to solve that today. So the problem that we have says solve for the current and the potential difference across all of the resistors A through E. And what we can start to do is think about our previous work. Our previous work, we had broken this down into equivalent circuits, you could say. If you go from, say, step one to step two to step three, as you get higher in number, it's a more summarized form, but you can still get information as you go from one to two to three and then work backwards. That's what we're going to be doing here. We're going to solve for the current in the entire circuit using the equivalent resistance for the entire circuit, and then work your way backwards to get as many pieces of the puzzle filled in as possible. And of course, what we're using is Ohm's law throughout this. So you could say the total potential difference, delta V, is equal to the current for the entire circuit times the resistance for the entire circuit. And so if you isolate for the current of the circuit, you can go ahead and plug in some of the values that we already know. We've already solved for the equivalent resistance in the previous screencast, and we know the delta V for the entire circuit, so we can solve for the current that's flowing through the entire circuit, 1.43 amps. Then what I'm going to do, and I highly suggest that you do, is as you work these problems, you need a lot of space on a sheet of paper, start labeling the stuff that you know. We know the current here is going to be 1.43. Well, how about the current through, say, A then? Well, that must be 1.43 as well. Same through B through C, same through D and E. That current is all in series, so it's all going to be the same. It's got no other option, no other place to go, so it must travel through that pathway at the same rate. Likewise, we can also label the first stage or the first step. And so now our diagram is getting more crowded, and you can see why I suggest giving yourself a lot of space on a sheet of paper to work out these problems. It will get a bit busy. All right, well, let's just go through A through E and see what we know and what we can solve for. So the first one we can do is the potential drop or potential difference for A is equal to I times R. And so you could say we know that, and we can use Ohm's law to solve for that. And we're going to go ahead and write that potential drop in. Now, if we move on to B and C, notice we've got an issue. The problem is we don't know what the current is through either pathway B or C. Now, we know the sum is going to be 1.43 amps, but we don't know what the individual currents are through these two pathways. So we've got actually two unknowns here. We'll come back to this. We're going to have to come back to this because it's a little more complex. So let's move on to D. And so we could say, again, just an easy problem here to solve for the potential difference or potential drop. We're going to label our diagram up above and do the last with E as well. Same sort of idea here, pretty straightforward. We label our diagram. All right, so what we're going to do is go back to B-C and think about what's going on here in this parallel section of the circuit. It's a little more complex, and I'm going to show you two different ways, two different options to be able to solve this problem. So the first option is going to be what we've been doing so far, and that is using Ohm's law and simplifying the circuit as much as possible, working your way down to the simplified version of the circuit, and then working backwards. So I'm going to show you what we have been doing. We don't know what the individual currents are in B and C, but we do know the overall currents for the equivalent section of the circuit is going to be 1.43 amps. So we can work with this in an equivalent way, and we can solve for an unknown. One of the unknowns we have is the potential drop from B to C. So that's what we're going to use and solve for. And I'm going to go ahead and label that up here as well. So now we have more information and we can solve for what we were looking for. So if we just focus on the B pathway, we now know the potential drop and we know the resistance, right? We already knew that. So we can solve for the current. And if we do that, this is going to be our current for B. I'm going to label that. And then we can go ahead and use a similar strategy for what's happening at C. So we solve for the potential drop at C, and this is going to be our answer here. Now notice when I put this in, it should more or less equal to each other. In other words, Kirchhoff's junction rule says that the current that flows into a junction is equal to the sum of the currents that flow out of it, or vice versa. And we more or less get that value here. Now I will mention there are some rounding issues because we can take sig figs throughout the problem, or we can take sig figs at the end of the problem. If you take sig figs throughout the problem, you may get some slight differences down to like the hundredths or the thousandths place, which we might get here. But more or less, that's a good way of checking your work to see if you have done the problem correctly. And next up, I do want to demonstrate Kirchhoff's loop rule. And this is going back to the concept that we talked about in the very beginning of the screencast, where I was talking about a waterfall here. So if we know the potential drop for the entire circuit is going to be 9 volts, and we know the potential drops of all of the other parts, so to speak, or portions of the circuit, we can solve for our unknown portion of the circuit. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. We're going to say this potential difference for the power source is equal to all of these drops. The subtraction of all of these drops is equal to 0. That's very much like when I started this lesson and I said the total heights for the water system that had the pump associated with it is equal to subtracting out then all of the waterfall differences is equal to 0, you could say. And that's what we're doing here, the same kind of thing here. It's just that our unknown is going to be this potential drop in pathway B-C. And if we do the subtraction here, solving it a completely different way, we get this answer here. Now notice there's a very slight difference between the two. And like I said, that's because of taking sig figs throughout the problem. There are a couple different ways of addressing that. One is to just take sig figs at the end of your problem and use the memory key on your calculator to keep everything exact as you go throughout the problem and take sig figs at the end of it. Or another is just to concede that you may need to be careful of the ends in terms of you may lose one sig fig of accuracy at the end of this process because there are so many different calculations that feed into it. And if you're taking sig figs throughout the problem, there are going to be some slight differences. But it is a good check. Actually, these two methods, if you do the two different methods, there are ways to check your work as you go throughout complex circuit problems. So hopefully that's been helpful. If you have any comments down below, please let me know. And I hope you all have a great day. Take care.